Okay. This is I Can't Wait For It. And today we're going to be going over Facebook and the curve and Wyckoff. And so Wyckoff schematics and the curve are pretty much the same thing. And so this is my brainchild. I'm going to give you a quick synapse of who I am. If you haven't heard my story, I'll just give you a quick overview. I can't wait for it. I had a traumatic brain injury about 6 years ago. I got hit from behind at 70 miles per hour, gave me 11 staples in the back of my head. I went to bed one night, woke up the next day, was a different person, and I had a huge desire to want to paint. I couldn't draw or paint before, and afterwards I can paint near realism on large scale, large portraits on canvas. And I picked up a spray can for the first time in my life and spray painted a mural 50 foot by 50 foot on the side of a building. So crazy stuff. It's you can look it up, WECT Scott Mel. I'm one of 33 people in the world that have acquired savant syndrome. That said, I started looking at the market and it kind of triggered me the same way that my art did. And I started seeing things. And so one of the first things I saw was this curve, in the market. And I automatically related that towards institutional buying and selling, even though I didn't know what that was. I have no understanding of the market before. I've only been looking at the market for the last 9 months, and ever since I saw that, it kind of intrigued me and it drew me in, and I spent 12 to 14 hours a day looking at the market and just making a rule set on what I saw in the market. I didn't look at anybody else's teachings. I didn't go to YouTube and try to figure out what everybody else was looking at. I wanted to see what the market was telling me, and I made my own rule set on what I saw, and I did that for 9 months, and then, or 8 months, and then I branched out and started looking in the mar on YouTube to see what else was out there that could kind of fill in the blanks on the things that I didn't know, like the technical terminology of what was going on, because I knew somebody had to be talking about it. And what I found was Wyckoff schematics, and it literally verbatim hits everything that I've found on the curve is identified in there. But the way that Wyckoff schematics is set up, it's just like 16 to 24 different steps in a Wyckoff schematic, and then there's three to four different variations of four different types of schematics that is just way too much for people to kind of grasp. And so what I've done with the curve is I've basically summed up the whole movement of institutional buying in five steps. And so I'm going to break down what price action is doing, relate that to Wyckoff, and then relate that to a step in the curve and kind of identify the two, so kind of blend the line between the two, and then show you what I see in the market and where I think the price is going. And I'll make a prediction on Facebook as well. So that said, let's go ahead and get started. And so what I want to do is I want to go ahead and I'm going to grab this arrow here. And so when price action runs up for a new high, that's going to be your last previous high, but that's also going for one on the curve, which is also, I mean, it's, so it's your, it's where institutional buying will see the price action running up for the new high. They'll get it to a price target, and then they'll start dumping, or well, they'll look to see if whether or not retail is going to run it up past this point, or start to fizzle out. And when you start to see wicks at the top of the candles, you know that retail is starting to fizzle out. And at that point, they dump a portion of their shares to see what the reaction is based on that. And so if the reaction gives back more than what they've dumped, then they stick in it for a little bit longer. But if the reaction comes back less than what they dumped off, then they dump the rest of their shares to drive it down into an area where price action hasn't cleared. And so if you look at this yellow dotted line, this is where the trend is of the price action for the last, pretty much the last month or more. And so price action hasn't dipped below this area. And this is what's called liquidity down here below the dotted line. That's the area where all the stop losses are for all the people who are going up in this market that are not institutional buyers. And and so whenever they see price hasn't dropped past a certain area, their stop loss usually lie right there. So what institutional buying has done is they've identified this area as a liquidity area. And so what they'll do is they'll drop their shares, and then once they run out of shares, then they'll start shorting the market to drive price down to get it past this point. And then retail will see this being pushed down, and then they'll jump in as fear of missing out, and they'll FOMO in, and that's what creates these long red candles like this, driving it down into a deeper area of liquidity. And then as it comes down into this area, you'll see institutional buying start to buy up portions of each of these candles coming in to soak up the float. And so once they've controlled a bigger portion of the float, let's say it's like 95, 99% of the float, whatever's left over in the float, they leave for retail to fight over. And that's what causes the demand to drive the price up. And so let's back up here. We've got one, which is the previous high. They see retail starting to fizzle out. They start distributing out, or yeah, distributing out their shares. And then it usually happens in three waves. So you got one, two, and then three right here. And by the time you get to the third, the end of the third wave, they already started soaking up the float. And by the time you get to this candle right here, they pretty much soaked up all of the float. And so then price runs back down again because retail's still trying to go down at this point, but institutional buying is already all the institutional buying has already gotten in. And so it's actually on its way up as retail's still trying to go down. And so then once they break those stop losses of those people trying to go down, retail trying to go down, retail's me and you, by the way, weak hands, then they immediately jump back in, seeing that the price action's going up, and fear of missing out happens again, and they jump in and start riding the price up. And so institutions will actually ride this price moving up for free. And that's our job, is to bring the price up. It's their job to soak up the float, and then that way they leave very little shares out there to create a lot of demand, and then we fight over the leftover shares in order to drive the price running up. And so two is the end of the distribution area, but it's also where they soak up the float, and it's called the major sign of weakness right here. And so the major sign of weakness will draw this, it will make a new low. And then when you see price action jump up and come back down, if the this leg comes down and but doesn't come as deep as this last leg right here, then that right there is the safest place to get in on the market. And so any institutional buying that hasn't completed yet at this point will do it right here on this candle. And that, because you'll see the price action will never, I mean, most likely will never come back to this area anytime soon. And so that's why this is the safest place to get in on the market, is the one leg up from the lowest low. And so then now, as they're fighting over the shares, price runs up to the top Bollinger Band up here. And this is what I call 3-4. And so I have 3-4 up here because I have them together because they're two separate things. Three is when price action actually hits the Bollinger Band for the first time. And you can identify three separate from one because three typically hits the Bollinger Band lower than the last attempt going high here. The last pullback after it starts to distribute, which is right before the last leg of the dump of the last leg, it does a pullback into the demand area right here and dumps off the last bit of shares that they had for profit, boom, and then distributes the rest of their contracts out and shorts the rest of it down. They start shorting the stock here. And so institutional buying does not make money on the way down. They don't make money shorting the stock. So, I mean, I don't know if you were misled into thinking that, or if that was one of the things that you were told. Institutional buying does not make money on the shorts. They hold those shorts. So they short the hell out of the stock, and they hold those negative these contracts, and they hold them until they come all the way back up to break even. And so that's why, whenever you see this distribution coming down like this, once they've gained control of the float, it's going to come back up to at least this area right here, because this is where they shorted the market to dump off these shares, or well, to get the price to drive down even further. And so they're holding on to these shares that they have to break even on or go negative on, but they can't make profit on these shares. So it's going to come back to this point, if not just for a brief second. And so that's why you see these long wicks reach all the way back up to a certain area so they can break even on them. And you'll see it just blast up there to get up there so they can break even on these things before it drops down to a lower area because they can't get control of the float. And that's a failed attempt at running the market up. But in most cases, a healthy market will do this. It'll come back up and 3 is when it touches this Bollinger Band, usually not higher than this area right here or the last previous high. And then once it gets to this area, this is where they start breaking even on those shares. So they let go of all their shorts that they had and then start dumping some of their, you know, their shares as well. And then that's where it starts to drop the price again back into the last point of structure, which is going to be down where 5 is over here, called the spring. And so 3, 4, I'm back up here again, sorry. 3, 4, so 4 is where price action rides the upper Bollinger Band going up. So 3 is when it comes up on the free ride. 4 is where retail will actually, if they are running this thing and they don't want to stop running it, it'll actually ride the price or ride the Bollinger Band going up. And so that's what we call 3, 4, is 3 hitting the Bollinger Band for the first time, then 4 coming back and riding the upper Bollinger Band as it goes up, as retail starts to fizzle out. And once retail fizzles out, then they start distributing out their shares again, and or dumping or breaking even on their shorts. And then it dips down into this last, into another area of liquidity. So over the last 20 candles right here, you created another trend line that hasn't been broken. So a lot of stop losses right here. And in order for institutional buying to gather up enough momentum to run for a new high at this point, they can't rely on the old momentum that they had right here because it already fizzled out. They need new buyers. So they dump their old shares, drive it down, drive price down again right here to this last area of structure, which is where usually right here where this last movement was before they drops down for the last leg, drops down to this area, and then springs off of this area and launches up for a new high. But they soak up the float again right here to take it for the new high, riding with new retail buyers to help drive up demand to run it up. And so just to recap, 1 is where you reach a new high, 2 is the distribution down into the major sign of weakness, and then the one leg up was the safest place to get in. That rides price action up for free. Institutional buyers don't spend any money to come up here. And so it ride the price action up for free. 3 is where it hits the Bollinger Band for the first time. 4 is where retail is still moving it up and it keeps hitting the Bollinger Band as it goes up, but they start to fizzle out. This is also where they start to break even on all the shorts that they did right here in this area. And then that causes the price action to come down, dip back into liquidity, break these stop losses of people trying to still go up, and then release all these old shares and contracts, gather up new shares and contracts, re-soak up the float, and then get retail to jump back in and push price action up again for a new high. And that's going up for 1 up here for a new high. Once it breaks this last previous high, that's where 1 it hits the upper Bollinger Band right here to go for the new high. And so that can just stop right here at this point and come right back down and start going down and start this process all over again, or it could keep going. Now, it's retail's responsibility to drive the price up. So wherever retail starts to falter is where price action stops. And so that's, you know, if they can't get everybody on the same, you know, side of the fence, then, you know, price action is going to fail to get to a new high. And so this whole thing that they do is a psychological game that they play to get everybody on the same side of the fence. By the time they get here, you know, they got every, you know, for the most part, they got everybody on the same side of the fence, but they can only go so high with that. So then they have to do this. It's kind of like a shorter process of this. They've already got half these people that are still in this. They're wanting to go higher, and half of them that probably have left and gone on to something else. And they, you know, so they drive it back down, gather up some new contracts, re-soak up the flow, get some more new retail buyers in that want to drive this thing up, mixed in with some of the old ones, and give it a us push to run up for that new high. Now, if retail doesn't get behind this thing and push it up the rest of the way, then they start distributing their shares out again, and they bring it back down to a low, you know, a new low deeper than where it was the spring right here. They'll probably bring it back down to this area right here, retouch this area down here, and then bounce up and try it again. And so that's institutional buying, and that's, you know, that's the curve on, you know, it's all summed up in 5 steps. And so the way this is laid out right here, this is a typical curve. It's how, you know, it would look right here. And so then this would be your price areas of interest, you know, bringing it down to 317 for the spring, you know, hitting that 326 area, coming up past the 326 area, and then bringing it back down to that 317. And then after hitting the 317, running up for a new high, you know, maybe up to that 356, maybe not, maybe just hitting the same area right here where the last high, which was 333. You know, maybe they run out of steam at 336 and they have to bring it back down. And then, you know, maybe they retry again. So they got, usually after they run up for a high, they got three attempts to break for the new high. And if they can't break for the new high, then it comes down. If they do break for the new high, then you can see this finding support on top of that high. And then hitting the bottom Bollinger Band and then running back up and hitting the top Bollinger Band again. And basically doing this whole pattern right here, but doing it in just three moves. Running it up to the Bollinger Band, bouncing off it, hit the bottom Bollinger Band, then running back up and breaking for a new high. Then coming down, finding support on top of that high, and then breaking up to try to find a new high on top of that high. And again, three attempts, and then after that, then they have to bring it back down and start this whole process all over again. So that's pretty much it. That sums it up. If you got any questions, please put them in the comments below. If you like more videos like this, if you want to know more about my story, or if you want me to run up, you know, do tickers and do breakdowns on those, these trend lines that I've drawn inside here are trend lines from the past movements, and they hold pretty tight, you know, because the same institutions that have made the trend lines in the past are going to be making the same ones on this one going forward. And so you're going to see the movements be ran pretty tight and almost pretty close to the same as the past. And so what I do is I match up the exact move in the past with the move going forward in the future, and then plot these out to see price action kind of have hiccups at the exact same place, find resistance here, come back down, find support down here, and respect the trend line. And I use it as a means of trying to figure out whether or not price action is going to respect the trend line. And if it does respect the trend line, then it gives me a reason to get in. So it's just a non-emotional way of having a reason to get in on a trade versus just seeing something and getting excited and emotionally making a decision to jump in, and then it turn around and come down on me because I made an emotional decision. So that's why I make these trend lines like this, and this is where I get them from, and they hold pretty true. So if you want to see more of my ideas, you can go to my idea page off my profile, and you can hit the play button. You can see the price action and see whether or not these hold true. And like I said, I'm not saying that they all will hold true. I'm just saying that the ones that do hold true are probably the ones that I'm going to play. Most likely are the ones that I'm going to play. And the ones that don't hold true, I'm probably just going to hold back and wait until they actually do start to show that they're going to respect the trend line. So anyways, that's it for me. I can't wait for it. That's the curve. That's my baby. Wyckoff schematics pairs with that pretty nicely. So if you got any questions, please feel free to put them in the comments below. And let me know what you think. Talk to you soon.